Today's podcast is brought to you by Blue Canary. The bird has landed on beautiful Bainbridge Island, conveniently located at 499 Madison Avenue. ASE Master Technician Clint Ramsey brings over 15 years of experience, award-winning diagnostic skill, and a desire to reinvent the automotive repair experience. Schedule an appointment online at bluecanary.biz.
What's good, PODCASTVILLE? You found the Bystander Podcast. Happy generic time of day to you. Big shout out to Blue Canary and Sound Reprographics for their support of the show. You can also support the show on Patreon. Today, we are welcoming back Dan Rosenberg. Danny, how are you doing?
Good. It's been a long time.
Yeah. You kind of blend into the gloom tomb here with the wearing all black today.
Yeah, I'm just a head floating around.
What's the 147 stand for?
That's a long story. Do you have time?
I have time. This is a storytelling medium.
So years ago, I had a radio show in Los Angeles called Car Calls, and it was all about the car industry. And we hired a new producer. And my co-host and I always met at the Starbucks across the street from CBS Studios. And I said, we'll meet you at the Starbucks. He said, what time? I said, and just threw this out, 1:47. Don't be a minute late. I said, but also don't be a minute early. And he literally walked in, and he was like standing outside. He walked in right at 1:47. And then from that day forward, I see the number 1:47 every day somewhere.
Wow.
And so when I did the sitcom, I wrote in a whole scene about my character and his ex-girlfriend having their own number. Because couples don't have numbers. They have a song, or they have mm-hmm. a place, or they have memories, but they had a number, and it was 1:47. So we were doing some of the screenings of the sitcom, and I went into a Lids and had the hat made.
Nice. Looks good.
Yeah.
It's not that long of a story.
It could have been longer.
Could have been longer.
I tightened it a little bit.
So sitcom, 5 years ago, you came on here talking about having a sitcom when you turned 50, was it?
Wow. Did I talk about that?
Yeah.
Yeah, so I had sitcom by 50 was the goal. And then I was 49, and I started doing, I had goals. I wanted to do a comedy special. I wanted to do the Seattle Comedy Competition. I wanted to do table reads of the sitcom. I wanted to finish all 10 episodes, which I did. And then the pandemic happened. Mm-hmm. And so the comedy special that we filmed at BPA here on Bainbridge came out February of 2020, and nobody watched it because we had no way to promote it. I planned to go out and do a bunch of touring and promote the special, and that never happened. I mean, a lot of people watched it, don't get me wrong. It just wasn't what I thought. And
that was on Amazon?
It was on Amazon, still there, 99 cents if you want to rent it.
Nice.
Or to be honest, you can go to YouTube. I put it up there for free.
So, I've seen it.
Yeah.
You and Rafi.
Yeah, I've got a long story about that we can get to also. I guess none of my stories are that long. I got a story about that.
Tell me a story about that.
So I set this goal to do a sitcom by 50, and I turned 50 during the pandemic. So then I changed it to sitcom while 50, because I thought, well, this will be over in a few weeks. That didn't happen. And then I changed it to sitcom in my 50s. So I've got 7 more years still to get it sold and done. But we did film it.
You filmed 10 episodes already?
Nope, just filmed the pilot.
Just the pilot?
And we changed, during the pandemic, we changed the entire concept of the show. It's the original concept. It was called Dan's Dad, and it was just about this loser sales guy who had a hot dad. And his dad was stealing all his girlfriends, and he was just this kind of a slime ball. And I wanted Rick Springfield to play the part. And I approached him. I met him a couple of times, and I was just always going after trying to get. And everybody's like, why Rick Springfield? I'm like, because the guy's, at that point was in his late 60s and looked younger than me. Mm. Good head of hair, in shape. And, I just kept trying and trying. And then during the pandemic, we did table reads of 7 of the 10 episodes on Zoom with a bunch of local actors. And we realized the dad character was a bit of a slime ball. And it was a bit of a Me Too type thing, because that all happened. And I'm like, you can't have this guy in his late 60s hitting on 20 and 30-year-old women. It's just gross. So my original writing partner, Eric Schemer, and I started doing a podcast, not really a podcast, like a live show on Facebook during the pandemic. And he and I just started rewriting the pilot. And we said, well, how can we make it so it's not slimy? And he just said, well, if you want to use Rick Springfield, make the guy a rock star. Then women are hitting on him.
Mm.
Then it's okay.
Yeah,
reverse the role. Yeah. So we said, okay. So we changed it. We made him a rock star. We put me working at a car dealership, which was part of the very original one. I was selling like internet services or something. I don't even remember what it was. So we put the whole show in a car dealership and came up with the name It's a Lot. He kind of double entendre of the name because it takes place in a car lot. And then this guy's life is a lot. And his old girlfriend is popping into his head all of a sudden. And her name's Leah, which is based on a song called Aaliyah by a guy named Donny Iris, who's huge in Pittsburgh. And that was, I think, the number 8 song it hit on the Billboard charts in the 80s. And I went to high school with his daughter. So I'm like, I can get the rights to the song. We can make that work. And so we filmed 6 days here in Kitsap County, most of it on either on the island or at Hudson Auto Center in Paulsbo. Mm. And then we went down to California for a day and filmed Rick Springfield. And we used somebody's house and shot 4 locations in their house. We have what's supposed to be my dad's kitchen, my living room, a rehearsal space, and then the exterior of us walking back after the rehearsal space. And that was all in one house in Calabasas in one afternoon or one day from 9 to 6.
What's the concept of the dad character visiting you at the parking lot or the car lot?
He doesn't, during the pilot, he never comes because we never have him show up here. Because we couldn't get Rick to come up here. It would have just cost too much money. Mm. So he calls me first thing at the beginning of the episode and says, hey, I need some help. I got kicked out of my rehearsal space. And we need some rehearsal space. You know, can you go with me to go look? I don't want to go alone. Can you go with me? So I go, okay, I'll go on my lunch break. And so we go to one of them. And the realtor that's showing it to us is, you know, just this blonde woman. And she's like, can't believe that Max from the band Gravenhurst, which is the little neighborhood I grew up in, Chippewa Township, Pennsylvania, that he's, you know, at her looking at, and she like takes a picture of his butt on the way out. And it's a funny scene. And it was the actress that we used, Kathy Jacobs, it was actually her house that we shot it at. And she had the Guinness World Record until Martha Stewart took it from her as the oldest swimsuit model on Sports Illustrated, I think in either 2020 or 2021 when she was 57.
Wow.
And now Martha Stewart did it like at 80. So she kind of broke her record.
Martha looks good.
For 80 and for a convicted felon, not bad.
I love the roast that she was on.
Yeah.
And she was saying, you know.
She was good.
I have more years in prison than all the rappers up here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And yeah. She's got good writers.
Good, talented person. I mean, I don't know what Kmart's doing anymore, but I think she took her brand somewhere else.
Yeah, she went to Sears, and then that didn't work out.
Then she hit Radio Shack.
Then she hit Radio Shack. Woolworth. I think she went to Woolworth for a while.
All these staples of, you know.
Staples. Oh, no, Office Depot. Oh, no, they're still around. They just merged with Office Max.
Is JCPenney around, too?
Yeah, they still went to Kitsap Mall.
Wow. Yeah, some of those you thought would never go out of business, like Radio Shack.
Yeah.
Then it became cheaper to buy plastic stuff from China that breaks down and just get something new again. And now that's why everybody has plastic floating in their blood and all the fish.
Speaking of JCPenney at the Kitsap Mall, Rafi Manassian, who you know from the last time we were on.
What's up, Rafi?
He plays the character Tony, who's based on a real character that I worked with at a car dealership in Los Angeles. And we needed a suit for him, so Rafi and I went to the Kitsap Mall, and we ended up buying him a suit at JCPenney.
No way.
And that's what he's wearing. He still has the suit. I let him keep it.
Well, yeah, it's not going to fit you.
No. But, you know.
He's a tall guy, though.
I could have returned it. We did that, actually. We went to, when we got to Calabasas, I went into Guitar Center. I bought a bass guitar, an electric guitar, and 2 matching amps. And I kept telling the story that, oh, it's my nephew's bar mitzvah this weekend. And I'm getting them each a thing and put this whole thing together. And then we go to shoot, and our bass player was Charlie Hall, who lives here on the island, who's the inventor of the waterbed, which is why my character wakes up on a waterbed at the beginning of the show. And
where'd you find a waterbed?
The inventor of the waterbed gave it to me.
And Charlie's got him laying around in the garage?
He had one. He had brand new in the package.
Does Charlie know that he is responsible for the phrase motion in the ocean?
Charlie knows a lot. He's got stories. I don't know if you've ever had him on, but
I met him briefly, I think, in the gas station parking lot when you guys all get together and talk cars on Thursday morning or whatever.
Just saw him this morning. Friday mornings now.
Fridays.
Jake's pickup at the Chevron station. And so he was my bass player because he happened to be in Santa Barbara at the time. So I said, you want to drive down to Calabasas? He goes, I would love to. Mm-hmm. So he showed up and he had on, you know, glasses and a hoodie. And I mean, you know, he's a guy that's in his late 70s and, you know.
Still rocking.
He came in and I put a bass guitar on him. He had never held a bass guitar before. And so Rick was giving him lessons on how to properly look like he was playing the bass. Mm-hmm. And then my friend Bert Teplitsky, easy name to spell, he was the guitar player in the band.
Yeah.
Never played guitar in his life. And so Rick had to show him. So I've got pictures of Rick like showing them both how to properly, just how to put the strap on. And Rick kept saying, hey, you want to take the tags off the speakers? And I'm like, I'm going to return them tomorrow. I'm not taking the tags off. So I kept the guitars. I had everybody sign them. And the two amps, I went back to Guitar Center the next morning and said, Aunt Sheila got them amps already. So, you know.
Well, you got to watch your money. You're financing the system.
Well, I had investors too, which helped. But the budget we did this for, you know, Barry Katz, who's our executive producer, showed it to a bunch of people when we were first just doing the edits. And the first guy he showed it to thought we spent, you know, $500,000 to $1 million on it. And the quality does look that way. I mean, we shot it with, you know, a red Komodo, which is a high-end camera. We shot it in 6K. It's
6K.
We shot it in 6K, then we downgraded it to 1080 and 4K. I think the final cut's in 4K. And Richard Malzahn, who lives on the island, I'm just dropping names left and right. Pick them up if you want. Put in the sound effect of all these names dropping. There's one.
Well done.
But you got some sound effects there, don't you?
Yeah, these aren't mine today.
So you never know what you're going to hit.
No, we can try something.
All right. Ah, reminds me of 1974. Or either that, hit that one more time. Behind Curtain 3, it's a new car! Thank you, Johnny Olson.
Another name drop.
Yeah. So Richard Malzahn, who was in the visual effects world in Hollywood, his IMDb page, he's got 100-plus
credits.
His first thing was Return of the Jedi.
Never heard of it.
Yeah, little independent film. And he was the last thing we had on the sitcom because we shot, obviously, at Hudson Auto Center in Paulsbo, and they've got a huge, gorgeous sign that says Hudson Auto Center. Well, now it says Lenny's Super Mega Autoplex. And there's a sign, I'm crawling in late to work, and I go in through the loading dock, and there's a big bare wall. It's just empty. And Barry Katz, our producer, he's like, you need something on that wall. And now there's a sign that says Lenny's Super Mega Autoplex. And you could not tell it wasn't really there. Like, Richard is a magician. And sadly, AI is able to do a lot of that stuff now. But he manually went in frame by frame. And because it tracks, like the camera's moving and I'm moving, and the sign goes right along with it.
Wow!
And there's no green screen. I mean, it's just there.
It's nice to have.
So yeah,
people with editing skills.
Yeah. So he did that, and our director Scott Breitbarth, who was, you know, I met him because he directed the 10-minute play that I wrote that was in the 10-minute play festival here on the island, and we just started talking about the play, and then all of a sudden he's like, "Oh, I went to USC Film School," and I went, "Oh," he goes, "I've got a camera and I've got this," and so we just bonded right away sitting at TNC, mm-hmm. and he ended up directing and editing the pilot, and he's now going to direct and edit my next comedy special.
Nice. Are you still working with the Bainbridge Performing Arts?
I'm on the board again. I was on for 6 years, and I termed out, as they say, and the new building opened, and they asked if I'd like to rejoin the board, and how can I say no? So I'm back on the board.
Awesome. They're a great organization.
Yes.
Dominique's leaving, right?
She's gone already. She left.
Where'd she go to?
I'm not sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
thinking back, I haven't seen her for a while.
Yeah, she took it all the way, scored the touchdown, got the new building. When I joined the board, they were just talking about, you know, this concept of building this new building. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if you've been there yet, but it's an amazing.
Yeah, I've been there. It's beautiful.
Yeah, it's an amazing building. And there's a studio space on the side now, so they can do little smaller shows and art shows. And I've been to a memorial there, and there's been, I mean, you can rent the space. I mean, there's an elevator that our Cars and Coffee group helped sponsor, because there's a guy named Tom Bryant who was the editor of Road and Track magazine. And was it Road and Track or Car and Driver? Oh my God, Road and Track. And he was on the board when I joined, and sadly he passed away. And so we all donated. We got all the guys in the Cars and Coffee group to come up with money. And so now it's the Tom Bryant elevator car, because it's a car, and he was a car guy. So you can ride the elevator.
Yeah, we have good theater space that's kind of underused, in my opinion, because we have the 400-seater in the BIMA, the Museum of Art.
That's 99 seats.
99 seats. And then the one over there at the Music Guild that had held Spacecraft for a while.
Yep.
Nice little theater in there.
Nice little theater. And then the high school has a 600-seat theater.
It's beautiful.
And but BPA, I mean, the seats that they put in, because I don't know if you remember the old seats. I have a set in my garage. That's the other cool thing. When I met Scott, he's got four of the seats from BPA sitting in his garage or in his house. And then Jesse Zebart, who was our first assistant director, just a huge help producing the sitcom, go to her place to suit one of the bedroom scene. We needed an extra shot, and we used her place. And I walk in, and there's BPA seats sitting there. So I'm
very
like,
cool.
These are my people.
Yes.
We all have that bond. And what's funny is the opening scene of the sitcom, we shot it in Charlie Hall's little car warehouse that he has right off Day Road. And we put the whole waterbed on the floor. But we didn't have these nice acoustic panels. And we couldn't record the sound in there. So the whole scene of me getting out of the bed is all on the waterbed. But all the talking scenes are in Jesse's spare bedroom on a normal bed. And I'm just kind of bouncing a little bit. And the camera's moving a little bit, and a little sound effect in the background. So it's two different locations, but the magic of editing.
Yeah. What was the final straw that got Rick to sign off and get on the sitcom?
A wheelbarrow full of cash.
That usually helps.
Actually, we might have overpaid him. We might have underpaid. I don't know. I don't know that he cared about the money. Mm-hmm.
He got that Californication money.
He was so funny in that show.
Yeah.
So was
Rob Lowe. He was funny in that show, too.
I had found his email address, and I started emailing him during the pandemic, and he responded. And so we were emailing back and forth, and then finally I was just getting desperate, because I'm like, okay, I'm going to be 51. Mm-hmm. I got to get something. I just want to get the commitment at least. So I just sent him an email. I said, hey, we're thinking of shooting this in September. Do you think it's possible, you know, you could just give me a number just so I can go to my investors and say, okay, this is what it'll cost to get Rick Springfield. And he wrote back, or no, he didn't write back. His manager, who I'd been trying to get a hold of, his manager, a guy named Wayne Sharp, his manager wrote me back and said, hey, you know, with the pandemic, Rick's really doing a lot of projects. He's super busy, but you know, we just don't have time right now, but you know, thanks for thinking of us. So I just wrote back real quick and I said, so if I had to deal with Netflix or Hulu, you guys would be on board, but right now you're not. He goes, exactly. You get a deal, you know, mm-hmm. you know, we read it, we're interested, but not now. So when I started working with Barry Katz, and I don't know if you know who Barry Katz is, he was executive producer and creator of Last Comic Standing on NBC. He managed Dane Cook, Jay Moore, Tracy Morgan, Dave Chappelle, Louis C.K., Wanda Sykes, Sarah Silverman. Like, he started all of their careers in New York. He used to have a club in New York called the Boston Comedy Club, ironically. And I met him years ago at the Montreal Comedy Festival. And I reached out to him when my clock was ticking, because I listened to his podcast, and he was interviewing Greg Garcia, who wrote the show My Name is Earl. And Greg was about to turn 50, and he's the one, he wanted to start doing stand-up by 50. So he was stand-up by 50, and that's where I got the idea of sitcom by 50. So when I reached out to Barry, sent him the script, and I was down in L.A. for another thing, and we had lunch together, And he's like, why Rick Springfield? He's like, you know, I live in Malibu. He goes, I live like a mile from him. I see him at the gym all the time. He's like, he's just an old rock star. Like, why him? I go, you know, he's an actor too. I mean, he can act and he's funny. And I go, plus, find me another. He was now 72 or 3 at this point. I said, find me another 72-year-old that looks that good. Mm-hmm. Because he does, you know.
Yeah, and Billy Squire is in the Hamptons.
Exactly. Billy Squire.
No, LeRoy Bell, who does the music here, and he played with G.E. Smith, dropped an album. He got invited to this, like, barn in Martha's Vineyard, and Billy Squire was opened up for him.
Wow.
He still had his head of hair.
So
and was rocking and thin and fit and looking good. I was like, God damn, that's Billy Squire.
Wow.
Unbelievable.
Well, there you go.
So that's two guys with that have aged that have good hair.
Yeah. But Rick has the acting chops too. I mean,
yeah.
He's the only person who probably did acting as his day job while he was doing music at night in L.A.
Back in the 80s, was he on a soap opera?
He was on General Hospital.
Oh, the soap opera.
Yeah. And his career just had that trajectory. Like, Jesse's Girl hit at the same time as General Hospital, going crazy with Luke and Laura and The Big Wedding.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it was colleges were changing their class schedule because kids wouldn't go. Because you couldn't record back then, obviously.
Yeah.
So, you know, 1 o'clock in the afternoon, whenever it was on, no one would do anything but watch General Hospital. And his career just skyrocketed.
My mom and her friends always taking lunch at 1 o'clock.
Yep.
So they could watch that.
Yeah. And so.
Crazy times.
I met with Barry Katz and I got him. I said, well, here's Wayne, you know, Rick's manager's info. I said, see if we can set up a lunch, you know, with Rick and Wayne. And Wayne agreed to have a lunch with us. So I was down in LA with Barry and we had lunch with him. And once I told him the whole story, the backstory of why I thought Rick was good. The other thing I forgot to mention is I was at a concert, a Rick Springfield concert, and I'm watching him on stage. I said to my buddy, I go, at this point, he was in his 50s, takes his shirt off. And to me, 50s was old. I was in my early 30s. Look at this guy, he's in his 50s. And women are like going crazy. This guy's old enough to be my dad. And that's where the idea for the hot dad popped into my head. So I told him that whole story. And you know, they had already read the script. And at that lunch, Wayne goes, all right, we'll do it.
Wow.
Because he's like, you know, Rick only wants to do things that are fun and have good writing.
Right.
He made a mistake on his movie that he did called Hard to Hold. He's always said that in interviews that it was horribly written and he shouldn't have done it. But he was hot and they wanted him to do a movie. I'm sure they gave him, you know, boatloads of cash to do a movie.
Yeah, it's either you or John Stamos, right?
Yeah. And another General Hospital alumni. And
with good hair.
And Ricky Martin. And Jack Wagner. There's a lot of people that came off of General Hospital.
Yeah.
And
Jack Wagner.
So, yeah. So, we came up with a number, and Rick was working on a film called Gonzo Girl. It was Patricia Arquette's directorial debut. And Barry said he called, and he was talking to Wayne. And he said, let's, you know, we have a day we want to shoot in November. And he didn't know he was on speakerphone. And Rick just said, Barry, act like you're my manager. Just get me as much as you can. Whatever it is, it is. And so we put out a number. And they said, okay, we'll do it.
So what's the status of the sitcom right now?
So our timing has been impeccable. Like I said, first we had the pandemic. Then as soon as Richard Malzahn finished the last visual effect, and we did our final, we did screenings all over the country. The final one was in Pittsburgh. I call it the Pittsburgh cut. Is our final. That's the cut that we're using now. It got the best response of all the cuts, and we went from 35 minutes, the first one we showed at the Bainbridge Cinemas, down to 22 and a half. Cut a ton out. We had a whole scene with Tiffany. You know,
The singer.
We're
alone now?
We shot at Marche here on the island, and we just cut it. It was really hard to do. It was a lot of money, but the scene just didn't work, so we cut it. It wasn't anything against her. It was more me and more the writing than anything. There were no jokes in it. That was part of the problem. So it was a dream sequence anyway. I had a nice head of hair. And it was a dream. I can have hair.
Yeah, it's your show.
Yeah.
Do
so
what
you want. As soon as Richard finished the last visual effect, the writers went on strike. And because the writers were on strike and we shot it as a union production, it was a SAG production, we couldn't pitch. We weren't allowed to. So that stopped us. And then the Screen Actors Guild went on strike. So that stopped us even more. Because now, even if we could pitch somewhere that wasn't a traditional network that was part of the AAMP or whatever it was called, we couldn't pitch at all now. And so once it finally ended, the problem we had was our goal was to find an executive producer that was like a famous writer who had a deal with the studio, and the studio had to deal with one of the networks. We were going to pitch it to them, get them attached to it, and then have them go out with it. The problem was during the writer's strike, all of them were at home writing. So they have all their own projects now. They don't want to grab onto some unknown person's project. So we picked a few networks that were small. And the first one was totally my idea. And I said, and Barry thought I was insane. I said, let's go to Motor Trend TV. They have their own network. They're part of Warner Brothers Discovery Network. They're all car related. And we have a car lot show. You know, the car lot's the fourth character in the show. It's like the bar in Cheers. Mm-hmm. And we reached out to them, and they said, we don't do scripted shows. We do reality shows. We do shows, you know, guys with beer bellies and beer staring at a transmission for a half an hour. You know, that's what we do. That's our show. And they go, but we like the idea. So here's our head of development. You should meet with him. So the guy said, hey, how about, you know, this is right before the holidays. He goes, how about, you know, I think it was January 10th, we'll have a meeting. So we had a Zoom meeting, and we showed him the pilot during the meeting. So he sat and watched the entire 22 minutes, mm-hmm. and then stayed on for another half hour afterwards. And it seemed like something was going to happen. I was excited. I said, there's no way our first pitch that we sell the show. Like, that just doesn't happen. You know, it takes, you know, 30, 40, 50 sometimes. Sometimes, I mean, Back to the Future, I think, was pitched like 60 times before somebody finally said yes. And that's Back to the Future. And, you know, Robert Zemeckis had already done a couple of films, so it wasn't like he was a nobody. And they reached out and said, we can't discuss it, but something's coming up with our network that might make it so we can't do the show. But give us a few weeks, we'll get back to you. And then it turns out Warner Brothers killed Motor Trend Plus, the network, and put it as part of Max, HBO Max. Now it's on the Max app. And they basically told them, no, you can't do a scripted show. Stay in your lane. You guys, this is what you guys do. You do the reality shows. Mm-hmm. You do the car rebuild shows. You do the, you know, the live coverage of the auctions. You are, you know, your reality. You're not scripted. And so they passed. And then we went to two other networks since. Both watched it and both passed for totally different reasons. But the way I look at the positive, you know, if you apply for three jobs and you get three interviews, your resume is doing well. You're getting your foot in the door. Mm-hmm. So we've got three more that we just went out to, all small. You know, we're not going for, you know, Netflix or Amazon or Hulu or any of the broadcast networks yet, mainly because I'm not a control freak, but I want to keep control of the show. I want the creative show to be what we created, not, you know, they'll say, okay, you got this kid, and it doesn't have to be me. I mean, I'm not saying I want to be the star of the show. I'm 100% fine with recasting me, because I was the worst actor in the show. We had some I did the Seinfeld thing. I surrounded myself with, you know, Chris Soldevia, who's, you know, here on the island, plays Eric, my best friend. Barbara Deering plays our manager at the car dealership. She's a fantastic actress. Dean Edwards from Saturday Night Live plays our boss. We flew him in from New York. He was on SNL for two or three years. And Rafi does the character of Tony, just knocks out of the park. And then, of course, Rick Springfield. And, you know, I was just being me. I wasn't really acting. I was just mm-hmm. trying to be, you know, the loser car sales guy that I used to be. And if somebody came and said, we'll do the show, but we want to recast you, I'd say absolutely. I'd rather be Larry David than Jerry Seinfeld. Mm-hmm. Although Seinfeld's a billionaire and Larry David's not. So,
really?
Yeah. Because Seinfeld did every season. Larry left after season. He didn't do season 7, 8, or 9.
Oh.
And Jerry also acted.
I got to get Max because I want to see the Larry David.
Oh, it's so good.
New show.
Oh, Kirby. At least do the free trial mm-hmm. and just binge it. This season's so good of Curb. But anyway, so that's where the show is. We're reaching out to these smaller networks because we hope they'll say, all right, here's your budget. Shoot it up there, because I'd love to keep it local. and just, you know, give us 8 episodes, give us 6, give us 10, whatever it is.
Yeah, I recently saw Chris in the film Ingress. Have you seen that?
I have not seen it. I didn't realize he was in it. I'm going to have to watch it now.
Yeah, and Eldridge, Matthew, was in it.
Oh. I did not know that either.
Yeah. Quite an odd movie. You ever think about doing YouTube? Show on YouTube?
That's probably...
The default, perhaps?
The way it will probably end up... We did a trailer. Scott Breitbart did a what I love working with Scott, by the way, quick shout out to Scott, is I have, every once in a while, I have a concept that pops in my head and I'll just create it. So I went in and I went on iMovie and I took clips from the pilot and I put them together and I said, I want a trailer kind of like this, but I don't know how to edit like you do. And within a day and a half, he sent me 99% done trailer. I mean, it was like exactly what was in my head. And when we were shooting the sitcom, I would say, this is how I want it, but I'm not going to direct. I need you to direct because I need to be in my head to be an actor. So I had to take off my producer hat, my creator hat, everything when I was doing the acting part. And he was able to find, he matched my vision very, very well. And we did a trailer. So the idea, I think, probably if we get to the point where we're just not getting a network, and the odds are, I mean, this is like a lotto. This is like a lottery ticket. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's astronomical to get a show picked up. And
But there has been proof. Like, I believe It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia started YouTube, perhaps, and then...
No, their story's pretty close to what we... They shot it on a camcorder. Mm-hmm. They had a concept, but they were all three working actors that had credits. So they tell the story as we're a bunch of... They were nobodies in Hollywood, basically. They were nobodies to America, but they had all been... They'd all done some acting.
And Workaholics, and I thought.
Started. Workaholics was similar with Comedy Central. But they took the show, put it on video, and they went in and they pitched it, and no one was interested. And then FX said, well, this isn't bad. Well, what are you going to do for the next 10 episodes? And they went, and they laid down the scripts. They had already written it. And so they gave them this tiny, tiny budget. And they said, reshoot the pilot. And they ended up, you know, becoming... It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia, which is a great show. So, yeah. I mean, there are some precedents, but the way Barry Katz always says to me is you're playing the lottery. Everything you add to the show is another ball that you're putting in to the bin.
Yeah, it helped when Danny DeVito signed on.
Exactly. So for me to get Barry Katz, that's a ball. To me to get Rick Springfield, that's another ball. So he wanted me to cast... Everyone else, like he wanted to have someone, he didn't know who Chris was. He didn't know who Tony was, Rafi. Rafi's never acted, you know, maybe in high school. And he did, you know, he's like, you're using nobodies. Mm-hmm. He goes, let's increase the budget. Let's find actors, name actors. Let's come down to LA, shoot the whole thing here. I'm like, I'm not running out of time, but I'm like, you know, I want to get this done. And so I told him, we're going to shoot a concept. You know, I got a local thing. Let's just shoot a couple scenes. And we shot the whole first half of the sitcom in August of 22 at Hudson Auto Center with just me, Chris, and Rafi. And we edited a bunch of it, sent it to Barry, and he's like, all right, I see where you're going. And so we kept the characters. We kept the actors. And then, you know, we met with some big-time directors. And he's like, you know, I want you to get a director attached that their name can help sell the mm-hmm. show.
Another ball.
But, you know, I use Scott. And then Barry now uses Scott for stuff. Like he's, you know, he's hired him to help with Brad Williams, the comedian.
Yeah, I like Brad.
That's one of Barry's clients. And, you know, Scott helped edit all his promotional stuff for his comedy special because of, you know, working with Scott on this. And... So a big shout out to Scott for just being able to help. So the goal is if we get to the point where all the networks were just not hitting, we're not finding a home, we'll recut the show a little bit and turn it into a short film. And then we'll enter it into film festivals as a short film. And we don't have to change much because it really is all, it's the one episode kind of ends on a cliffhanger to make you want to watch to see what's next, which really... With a short film, you kind of want to do that too because you want the short film to become a feature or you want it to turn into a mm-hmm. series. And then if that route doesn't work, then I just lean on Rick Springfield's fans to start, you know, we cut it into little 5-minute episodes and we put it on YouTube and we built a channel just for it, you know, the It's a Lot channel. And his fans are so good. I mean, he has such a fan base. When we screened it in Pittsburgh, there are women that drove 5 hours from Michigan to watch it in Pittsburgh. I mean, they drove 5 hours to sit and watch 20. And when the women showed up, you know, Rick's not here, right? Oh, we know. We just want to see this. No. You know, we heard about it because there was a couple articles about it. And then Rick actually was interviewed and it was brought up in one of the articles. And so he talked about it in an article in Houston. So I now have his fan base sort of like kind of, you know, they'll come support it. They all want to see it.
Well, this podcast, you're going to have this fan base too. So that should add another 10 people.
Hey, every 10 people helps.
You got another comedy special. What did you learn from the first one that you did on Amazon?
How much time do we have?
Got all day, Danny.
So we're taking our little water break here for people at home. If this was NPR, yes. If this was NPR, we'd have no water because they all have dry mouth.
Yeah.
Welcome to NPR. So in 2019, I went to Dominique Cantwell and I said, you know, I'm not filthy, stinking rich, but I want to do something that'll help with the capital campaign for the new BPA. And my idea is to do a comedy special. And we'll charge three different pricing tiers. $25 is the regular ticket price. $50, and for $50 you get, it's the same as a $25, but now you've donated double. Gives you a warm feeling inside. Mm-hmm. For $100.
You get a glass of wine with $100?
No, you get your name in the credits. You get a special thank you. So at the end of the show, there's a big list of people that put in $100. So we did tiered pricing. We raised about $5,500 the night that we filmed it. And we filmed it with a bunch of DSLR cameras.
Cameras, yeah.
And we had one in the upper corner where the sound booth is. We had one in the opposite corner. My son was manning that one. Richard Malzahn was walking around with his, getting different shots at different angles. And we had another camera in the front row, about the fifth row. And David Rabin, I don't know if you know David, he had his really nice camera, huge lens. But we had a couple of technical glitches. His camera overexposed me. And I'm not sure how it happened, if it was a lens issue, because we checked it beforehand, everything looked good. But when Richard got the footage, he called me, he's like, you're not going to like what I'm about to say. I'm like, why? He goes, I can't use any of the main shots. And the camera on the other side, we were using this newfangled recorder so we could have the camera. DSLR cameras only go for like 9 minutes or 11 minutes or 30 minutes before you have to turn it off and turn it back on, because they're not video cameras. Mm. And sometimes they get too hot, and there was all kinds of rules. I don't know what it was. So my son had to like start and stop his, and Richard had to start and stop his, and David had to start and stop his. So we had this other one hooked up to a hard recorder and it didn't record anything. And then the audio from the audience, we had the audience mic, we had mics hanging from the ceiling that the BPA already had. I listened to the first audio and it was just me, no laughter. And I'm like, oh my God, did I bomb? And Richard's like, yeah, I guess he forgot to turn up the audience on the soundboard.
Like before we got started, I told you my horror stories.
Yeah.
You know, it happens.
We had no audio and a horrible picture. And Richard's like, and he's the visual. I go, you can't fix this color. He goes, if it was a RAW, if we shot it in RAW, which none of the cameras we used were that high end. He's like, yeah, we could have. He goes, there's no data there. He goes, I think I can fix it though. He goes, let me send you something. So he sends me something and it was in black and white. His black and white works. He's like, I can make them all match. And he's, you won't believe I got, and the audio sounded great. I can hear the audience. I hear the audience. He goes, the camera that glitched out on the video got perfect audio because he was sitting in the audience. So the surround, you can hear the audience perfectly. Mm-hmm. So he mixed the audio tracks of, you know, I was wearing a lavalier. Plus we also had the board mic. We mixed that.
Lavalier. I mean, it's like the whole tiramisu argument again.
Did I say it wrong?
I don't know. I've never heard it.
A lavalier. No, it's a lav mic, but it's a lavalier. Am I saying it right? Lavalier?
It doesn't sound right to me for some reason.
Lavalier.
It's the microphone you clip on your shirt.
The little clip-on mic. And so we did, he fixed it. But we had to do it in black and white. So Rafi and I recorded this little thing beforehand where, you know.
Walking around backstage.
Yeah, he knocks on the door. He's like, hey, I got this idea. And we walk back and forth. He's like, you're a nobody. You do something different. Do something that's going to make it stand out. He goes, black and white.
Ah, that was clever.
So we took lemons and made lemonade. And
because when I watched it, I was like, what are they doing? You know, yeah. Just walking back and forth. This is kind of driving me nuts. Get on stage and tell some jokes.
Yeah. And so then, so we do it in black and white. And then Richard says, I got your title. I go, what? He goes, overexposed. Because you were overexposed. And so perfect. That's why we call it overexposed. And the irony is, it's got double meaning. I'm a nobody. Like, nobody knows. I'm not overexposed. You know, mm-hmm. like, you could say, like, Shane Gillis got overexposed or Matt Rife got overexposed. Because these guys, you just hear them everywhere all of a sudden. I was not overexposed, but the image was.
Shout out to Matt. You're welcome on the podcast anytime.
Yeah. And so it was just, you know, this amazing thing. And then we put it on Amazon and it got a bunch of views and, you know.
It was number one for a while.
Well, the audio version was number one. Hmm. The video never was, but the audio, I took the audio in December of 2020 and released it as a CD / album. And because, and now the secret is, and I know this now, if you're going to release a CD, do it in the week between Christmas and New Year's, because the music industry is shut down pretty much the month of December. There's no new releases. Mm. So, and especially in comedy. So I got lucky that I was the number one new release. And then I looked at, I'm like, oh, cool. I'm the number. And I thought that was cool. But then I looked at the actual chart for all comedy albums on Amazon. Mm-hmm. And I was number one. I was being Weird Al Yankovic, which was so cool. And we didn't sell a lot. I mean, mm-hmm. but still, it is cool that we debuted at number one. And so I was talking to Barry Katz a few weeks ago about some comedy stuff, because now he's helping with some of my stand-up. And I said, I really want to do a new comedy special. And I said, but, you know, I burned all that material. He goes, nobody watched that. He goes, in the grand scheme of things.
Well, you got new material by now.
I have a lot of new material. He said, you could redo that entire special. And do it in color and do it with professionals instead of volunteers. I mean, everybody that helped, thank God they helped because they made mm-hmm. the show. And Richard Malzahn was the only person that was a professional.
So that's what you learn? Professional people, professional cameras?
Pay people. And even with the sitcom, I had a few little things after the fact that some people volunteered to do a couple little things. And when people are volunteering, you're very low on the priority list. And I don't blame them. You know, if you told me you wanted me to come MC something for free and I got a paid gig, I'd have to call you and say, yeah, I got this paid gig. Sorry, mm-hmm. I can't come. And, you know, that I wouldn't expect different. You know, same thing if I asked you to do something, it was for free. Mm-hmm. Like today, you know, this, you're not paying me to be here and, you know, you're not being paid to be here. But if something came up that I was getting paid or I had something to do.
We'd reschedule.
I'd be like, hey, sorry, I got to reschedule. So what we're going to do with this special is we're doing it on a Wednesday night, May 22nd at BPA, two shows, 6 o'clock and 8 o'clock. That way we have tons to edit from.
Yep.
We're going to do 6 cameras total, 4 6K cameras that'll be in the you know, we blocked off seats already. So we have stage left, stage right, dead center, and then a roving camera, and then two backstage cameras shooting out. And then a Zoom recorder with microphones pointing at the audience, and then a lav microphone, a tiramisu microphone, and the board, miking off the board. So we're going to have like 4 versions of audio, 8 versions of video. We're not going to miss, you know, we're going to have everything covered and shoot it twice. And we're also going to show the sitcom pilot. I'm not going to have any other comics on the show. I'm putting all the money into the crew. And we'll have, you know, the opening act will be me. So we're actually going to reshoot the opening video. We're going to do it in black and white. We reverse it. In black and white, Rafi's going to knock on the door. And he's going to say, hey, I go, what are you doing here? I said, no, get out. Your advice was horrible last time. He goes, what? I saved it. And I said, well, we had the camera glitch. We had the sound glitch. You know, we had it called overexposed. He's like, okay, I got it. Here's what we're going to do. Walk with me. Talk with me. Then we're going to do the exact same walk, except now the new BPA. So the hallway's gorgeous now, well lit, brand new paint and carpet. Everything looks great. And we're going to walk back. He's like, do it in beautiful color. Here's what you're going to call it. Properly exposed.
Love it.
And so then I'm gonna walk out. We're gonna use the same intro, which is my buddy Eric. He pre-recorded the intro. Run the exact same intro, and then as I walk out on stage, it'll all of a sudden go from black and white to color.
Are you and Eric still doing the Airdan?
Every Monday night, Airdan Film Festival on Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, and Twitch. Although we're gonna consolidate. We realized having it on too many
platforms,
too many flatware, it doesn't help.
Right.
Because, you know, if we get 3 people here, 10 people here, 4 people here, if we had 30 people at once liking and commenting on one platform, the algorithm's going to build that one up.
Right. So what's your platform of choice?
Probably YouTube. So stream live on YouTube, because you don't have to log in to watch. You mm-hmm. don't have to have a membership. If you do want to log in, it's your Gmail account, which a lot of people have. Facebook is, you know, slowly
dying. Yeah.
We could stream on Instagram now, but I'm like, you know what? Let's just focus. And then the show I do with Rafi every Saturday morning was called Clutch Radio. And we couldn't brand that because there's a band called Clutch. There's clutchradio.com already. And I owned caryada.com. You know, like yada, yada, yada. Yeah. It's like just talking about cars. And so it's now Caryada, we call it. And we actually have a phone number, 877-CAR-YADA. We've got 610-CAR-YADA if you want to text us. We've got caryada.com, and we have a Caryada YouTube channel. And so we're going to focus pushing it all just on Caryada.
Nice. Well, if you have some advice or somebody that can help me get some video in here, I'd love it.
I can tell you, I mean, from what I've done, I wouldn't call myself an expert, but I can probably help because
I'll take you up on that.
Get a cheap DSLR. These computers are more than powerful enough, and use StreamYard.
Gotcha. All right.
And I can get you a discount on StreamYard. I can give you a referral code.
Nice. Isn't there a free version?
There's a free version, but you have to have their logo stuck up there the whole time.
Yeah.
And you don't want that.
Okay.
Do the slightly paid version.
And you got a book on hosting coming out?
Oh, God. We've gone a while. I didn't realize that.
Yeah, we're going.
So the book on hosting I wrote in 2006. It's called The Book on Hosting, How Not to Suck as an MC. And in my years doing stand-up, I learned a lot of lessons on how to host a show. And I became a good host because, A, I taught comedy traffic school in Florida. That's the biggest reason.
What is that?
So in a lot of states, if you get a speeding ticket, you can go to traffic school and they'll knock the points off. But you can only do it once every 3 years. So if you're a repeat offender, or repeat violator, as we call them, then you can't keep doing it unless it's court ordered. So in Florida, they had comedians teaching it. And they found that, and my friend Bert Toplitzky, who I mentioned earlier, he was my boss, that's how I met him. He owned the traffic school. And they found that by using humor, people retained
the information.
People that went to the comedy traffic school, maybe 1 out of 100 would get another ticket in the next 3 years. People who went to the National Safety Council, it was like 30 out of 100. It was like a huge percentage would get another ticket in the next 3 years. So it actually was better. And he was the most expensive also in Orlando. He charged the most, but he was the number one. He ran more students through than mm-hmm. any other of the schools. I think he was larger than everybody else combined. That's how big it was. And I taught like 400 classes over 2 years, at 4 hours each. Wow. So I had 1,600 hours of solid training of being in front of people for 4 hours that A, were sober, B, didn't want to be there, and C, I wasn't allowed to be offensive because it was a state-sanctioned thing. So I couldn't do anything political. I couldn't do anything racist. Not that I would be up there doing political racist humor. But I learned a lot of things of how to engage an audience. And Bert and I started a comedy club in Culver City, California called the Comedy District back in 2006. No, 2004. And the month, I was gone for a month. I went to 4 weddings. One of them was my own. And I had someone else host the shows. And one of the comedians that was headlining the show messaged me and said, if that guy ever hosts again, I'm never doing your club. He goes, you need rules. You need to tell these people how to host. Mm-hmm. He was going way over. He was, you know, doing too much material. It was all about him.
So have you rewritten this book, revised it? Or?
I have not. I wrote the book in 06. Every year I was like, I'm going to rewrite it. Mm-hmm. And literally 4 days ago, I was talking to a friend about the book, and I realized, why would I try to rewrite this? The rules all apply, other than references to MySpace and Palm Pilots that are in the book. I'm going to turn it into a podcast. Mm. So I'm going to start the podcast on hosting, How Not to Suck as an MC. And I did a little trailer because all the podcasts, you know, they need something to get it launched. So it's already up on Amazon and Apple and Spotify and Audible and iHeartMedia or iHeartRadio. And so I've got my little trailer. And then the first episode is just going to be me alone just reading the book, basically, the 25 rules. These are the 25 rules to make it so, and I guarantee anybody who follows these rules will not suck as an MC. You might not be good, but you won't kill the show. Mm. And one of the most simple things is be likable. That's rule number one. Because you get people to get up there, and if the audience hates you, why are they going to, what? You just killed the show.
Yep.
If you're not a likable person, don't MC. You know, you could be an unlikable comedian. If you're funny, and you know, you have a certain style and you're blue and political and dirty, great. Don't be an MC. That doesn't work as an MC.
Right.
And the other one is, you know, people give the name. Like if I was going to introduce you, you know, I'm not going to say, so Tim Self's coming up next. And, you know, he's got this great podcast. And here he is.
Right.
You always, your name is the punchline. So the setup is he's got a podcast. He's been doing it for 7 years. He's got this. Tim Self. Mm-hmm. And then people applaud. People are conditioned. They hear the name, they applaud. Simple thing like that. And so there's 25 rules. I'm just going to read them. I'm just going to go through, read them. I have a teleprompter set up. It'll be probably 20, 25 minutes. That's episode one. Then I'm going to reach out because in the book, I have a whole bunch of comedians that told little funny stories about hosting. And I'm going to reach out to all of them. I think only one has passed away since 2006. And I'm going to have them on as guests, and we'll just pick one rule. You know, this week the rule is, you know, get 3 interactions from the audience before you start. And my guest is Bert Toplitzky from the Improv Comedy Traffic School, who's, you know, got a few comedy specials under his belt now, and you can hear him on Sirius XM, blah, 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 blah. So he and I will then talk for however long, and we'll talk about that one rule, and we'll just share stories about it. And so if you want to become a better MC at comedy shows, you subscribe on YouTube or your favorite podcast provider, and you'll learn how to be a better MC.
Are you a fan of any local up-and-coming comedian? Not like a headliner or a national name, but anybody out here in Kitsap County and Seattle area that has caught your eye?
There's quite a few. I just worked with Jackie Turgeson is her name. I was one of the judges for the Seattle Comedy Competition when it came to BPA, and she won that night. And she needed to win to make it to the finals. Like, she was in sixth place going into that night, mm-hmm. and or maybe even seventh. The only way for her to make the finals was to win that night, and she brought it. And she's really good. She's got 3 kids, and so when I did Dan Rosenberg and Friends back in January at BPA, I had her as one of the comics, and she just slaughtered it again. And I think she's got a future. And then we did a show at the Roxy the following week in Bremerton. And also Jody Carroll and Rachel Ajafi. I hope I said her name right. I had 3 female comics with me, and they were all just knocked it out of the park. And they all have, I think, a great future. Mm-hmm. I don't know the comedy scene nearly as well because I just haven't been going out and meeting a lot of the local comics.
I've been fortunate. Quite a few have come on the podcast now, and I think I met every one of them through the International Comedy Festival.
Okay.
And so I've surrounded my friend group with a lot funnier group lately.
Yeah.
Chris Mejia, Bo, of course, is great. Erin Engel was on.
Yep.
She's hilarious.
I had her at the theater.
Congratulations, Erin, on your new baby, by the way.
Yeah, I had Erin, Bo Johnson, Dwayne Goad.
Bo's going to be a superstar.
Yeah. Yeah.
Adam Tiller. That's another guy I had on. Love his comedy.
I forgot who the 4th comic was. Oh, Mary Jo Gamba. I had 4 headliners, basically, at BPA when they were at the theater. And it was during the pandemic. So the audience was masked. And I pre-recorded a thing on StreamYard of us picking the order, who's going to go first. And so I had a wheel that spun, and that's how we decided, you know, who would go first. All four of them killed that night. I mean, it was an amazing show.
How do you feel about positioning, you know, going up against before or after somebody?
It's actually in the book. You know, a lot of times if somebody kills, somebody just slaughters.
Well, it's a little different for an MC because there's a master of ceremony.
Right, but their job as the master of ceremony is if somebody kills, sometimes you have to bring the show back to zero.
Then oh, reset?
You have to reset. If somebody bombs, you definitely have to bring it. Yeah, you have to do 30 seconds, bring them back up. Because nobody wants to follow somebody that bombed. So the MC's job is to bring the show back. If somebody kills, normally you want the show to, oh, the show's doing good, bring the next comic right up. If somebody just slaughters, like has the set of their life, knocks it out of the park, a lot of times comics will be like, I don't want to go up after that. I don't want to follow that.
I don't want to follow Joey Diaz.
Right. So it's like, all right, bring it back down just a notch. Bring it, you know, so they'll go back up. Not
that's the Ron White school of comedy where you think you're going slow, slow down even more. You think you're going fast, slow down even more.
Yeah. And so it's just, you got to get it back to zero. I would rather be on a show with killers mm-hmm. than, now when I started, I wanted to be the best comic on the show. That was always my goal. Like, it's not a contest, but right. At the end of the night, I was like, well, I was the best. And I'm like, it was an open mic. Who cares if you were the best at the open mic? I would rather be, you know, like the show I'm doing in Pittsburgh in 2 weeks, I asked Augie Cook, who's a Pittsburgh legend. The first open mic I ever went to just to watch, he was performing. And the first open mic I performed at, he was on. And I opened for him a ton of times. He was the headliner. I was either feature or the MC when he was the headliner. And he came to town last summer to watch the Pirates play against the Marlins. Not the Marlins, the Mariners. What team do we have here? The Maryland. Mariners.
I don't know. Everett Aqua Sox, are they?
Yes, the Aqua Sox. And, you know, his whole family was here, and he invited me and my son. My son couldn't go, so I took Scott with me. And we had, you know, we sat and watched the Pirates game. And Pirates won, which was nice, since I'm from Pittsburgh. It's the only time I root against the Seattle team. And I was like, you know what? I'm doing this show in Pittsburgh, back at the theater where we screened the sitcom last year. The only person I want to work with is Augie, but he might not want to open for me. But I know it'll be a great show. Mm-hmm. You know, it's two headliners, really. And I asked him, and he said, yeah. So, you know, I'm honored that he's going to do it, but I know it's going to be a good show. And I'm an MC, too. I'm going to go up first, welcome everybody, do all the MC
stuff.
Introduce
yourself?
Probably.
That'd be kind of funny.
And then introduce Augie, let him do a half hour, probably. And then I'll come back up, introduce myself, do my 45 minutes, and then call it a day.
That'd be funny. And now Dan Rosenberg, and then you walk off stage and then come right back on stage.
I don't know if that was in the book or not, but that's the thing that if you don't have an MC, do it yourself. Mm-hmm. You know, and if it's a two-person show, that's how you just introduce yourself. Like you come out, you talk. Oh, you ready for your first comic? And you kind of look off. You ready? Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, this first comic, you say a bunch of things. Dan Rosenberg, and they probably don't even know your name.
Right.
So you walk off stage, you come back out. Thank you. Hey, big hand to that guy. Good looking fella, huh?
Yeah.
Stole my act. Can't believe you wore the same clothes as me.
Exactly.
And you'll get people to go, wait. There's always one drunk guy that will be like, is that the same? It's the same guy.
So, Pittsburgh fella, how do you feel about Russell Wilson going to the Steelers?
I'm happy. I think he's... Russell Wilson, when he's humble, is one of the greatest quarterbacks out there, and he's been humbled by what happened in Denver. And the fact that the Steelers only have to pay him $1.2 million,
yeah,
and Denver has to pay him $38 million, and he has got to go into Denver and beat them in Denver while they're paying him $38 million.
That'll be a game to watch.
That's beautiful. And I think he'll do fine, and I think Justin Fields is the future.
Yeah, I kind of feel bad for Cody Pickett, though. You know, he was doing really well. He did everything right, played at the university there, and then he got hurt and then never got his spot back.
He had 8 touchdowns in 2 years. He wasn't doing well.
Yeah, but, I mean, I thought he was because he was coming along. He was never meant to be the guy, right? So I thought if that's your third string or second string, you know, they're going to bring him along for a long time.
But he was a starter. I mean, they brought him in to start.
which was crazy. That was premature in my
he
mind.
Was, I think the
just
last...
kind of like Justin Fields. I think it was premature to put him in as a starter.
The last time the Steelers picked a quarterback first in the first round, I believe, was Terry Bradshaw.
Yeah.
So...
Well, he won a few times.
He did okay. But Ben Roethlisberger was first round, too. I take that back. But like Russell Wilson wasn't first rounder. Yeah. And look what he did here. I just think he got too big, and I think...
He became very fake, in my opinion.
Yeah. And I think the stuff he's... I think he's going to go into Pittsburgh grounded. I think they've got a much better organization and than Denver.
Better coach than Denver, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's no nonsense, and he's not going to throw somebody under the bus like Sean did.
Yeah. I think Sean Payton was a great coach in New Orleans because he had, again, great ownership and a great staff. You look at some of his assistants that went on, he had a really good staff.
Yep. And that's the whole argument of surrounding yourself with people that are better than you.
Yeah. It takes a long time to realize that's important. When I coached basketball, I did the same thing. Mm-hmm. You know, I was never the oldest. Both times I coached basketball, I was the youngest person on the staff. When I coached in Pennsylvania, and then when I just coached, well, my God, 10 years ago, 11 years ago at North Kitsap, I was the youngest person on the staff. And I was 42.
Yeah, you can't be afraid of competition. Competition makes you stronger, and if you're secure in who you are, it's good to have those people around you.
Yeah.
You can learn from. All right, anything else up and running?
Wow, I can't believe we're done. Well, I've got all my social media at Dan Rosenberg 3, number 3, not 147, which I probably should change all of them. So if you're not following on Instagram or YouTube, please do. And the show at BPA should be a ton of fun. Plus, showing the sitcom pilot, we might get some Rick Springfield fans to drive in.
Okay.
Not from Michigan this time, but probably.
I did have fun on the Air Dan show that one time. Thank you for having me on. That was fun.
You should be on again. Come on whenever you want.
Yeah, for the longest time, I forgot what day it was.
And
then I was playing futsal for a long time, Portuguese soccer game.
Oh.
On Monday nights.
Well, we did every day of the week. So Friday, March 13th, 2020, I went on YouTube, on Facebook, because I used to do a show in New Orleans called Dead Air Live, where it was just me talking to whoever would call in. It was a half hour. I did 62 episodes, I think. And it was a fun show. And I'm like, I'm just going to recreate that. And I went on every night of the week. And then it got to the point where my wife was like, all right, you know, enough.
Come home.
Yeah, I was home. It's just, you know, I'd go upstairs to the little spare bedroom. And then we consolidated it down. It was three shows a week, and then it became just...
Once a week.
Once a week with Eric, and then once a week with Rafi.
Perfect. Say what's up to Rafi for me, okay?
I will. I'll see him tomorrow morning.
All right, Dan Rosenberg, thank you for your time. I appreciate you coming in today.
Thank you. Always fun.
And I'll look forward to seeing you again. You've been listening to The Bystander. Be kind.